Morning, gentlemen. How's everybody doing?
Feeling good. Feeling good. Morning, good. Sisters. Morning, brothers. Morning, comrades.
Morning.
Afternoon, even.
So, to jump right into it, what I'd like each of you to do, starting with you, Brother Kevin, is just talk for a couple of minutes about exactly what it is you do, literally about what you do. Don't be modest, because I know all of these gentlemen quite well, so if they are modest, I will start pulling up some of the things they've done. But just talk to us a little bit about what your day-to-day lives consist of on a professional level.
I'm a criminal lawyer, solicitor advocate, High Court solicitor advocate. Day-to-day, I'm either in the Crown Courts or I'm in the Magistrates' Courts and occasionally at the police station. I'm a defence lawyer. So that's the day-to-day. I would consider myself... I do consider myself a movement lawyer, trying to break down the barriers between the priesthood of the legal profession and the people we are supposed to serve.
Okay.
So from that point of view, I consider myself a movement lawyer. Embryonic in its nature, because to be a movement lawyer, to recognise that being a lawyer is not just about litigation, but it's also about empowering an understanding of the role and nature of criminal law in capitalist society, but also recognising the possibilities and the limits of the law. And when you recognise the possibilities of the limits of anything, you then recognise the possibilities of your own self and collective possibilities. But anyway, that's to stray away from what I do on the day-to-day. I go to court. I look at the prosecution evidence against my client, or I go to the police station and I look at the police evidence against my client as to why she or he, usually he, has been detained. There are all sorts of bourgeois concepts with regards to the obligations you have to the justice system and obligations to the court as an officer of the court, but I'm quite explicit. My job is to get you off. My job is to get them off, not to lie for them, not to disabuse in any way any ethical procedures or understandings. Never, but the criminal law functions as a tool of control. You've got a notion of equality of arms between the state and the criminal lawyer. That's why. One has a criminal lawyer, but we live in a different reality. And so my obligation is to, as best as I can, function in a way to represent the person who is detained or represent the person who's at court, which is to do for themselves that which they would do if they had the legal understanding and the legal education.
Thank you very much.
Fantastic. My name is Andrew Mohammed. I'm an author, historian, and an independent educational consultant. On a daily basis, my job or my career is that I go into schools, colleges, universities, prisons, and I motivate young people to reach their targets, to reach their goals, to believe in their dreams, to have dreams. I work with teachers on inset days to improve teaching standards, motivate teachers, make them understand that they're doing a phenomenal job in society, and show them different ways and different techniques of working with hard-to-reach young people. As an historian, my aim and ambition is to teach the youth, especially the African Caribbean youth, that they are coming from a culture of high civilization. I personally believe that this is a personal mission of mine, is to go into the schools, colleges and universities and show those young people they've got a future, and that future is based on understanding their past. I've had the pleasure of traveling to places like Africa, the Caribbean, Europe, across Europe and what have you, okay, doing that exactly same thing. So I realised that it's not just the youth in London or the UK that need this information, it's needed right across the world. And so with the work that I've done, I've created my own company called The Investigators, and we go around, especially the UK, uplifting the youth. We work with all youth regardless of their age, colour, creed or class, but I'll make no apology that we do specialise, and I do have a very special place in my heart for the Caribbean and the African young brothers, because I personally believe that they need that extra guidance, that extra motivation to make them appreciate they are absolute geniuses.
Thank you very much. Dr. Onochie?
All right, I'll keep it concise. So I'm Elliot. I was born in Nigeria, but I've qualified as a medical doctor here at Imperial College London. So I currently practice in trauma surgery at the Royal London Hospital, which is one of four major trauma centres in and around London. So we get the helicopters for major trauma, and we deal with those events. Day-to-day basis involves about 3 days or 4 days operating on elective, so planned cases or trauma cases, and otherwise operating clinics. The hospital I work at currently is based in Whitechapel, which is of a high proportion of mainly Southeast Asian population. So the general day-to-day clinic cases we deal with are often interacting with that cultural background. In my previous training, which has all been in and around London, based around the Imperial College hospitals, I've done cardiothoracic surgery, lung surgery, hepatic surgery, breast surgery, bone surgery, and other things, accident emergency. Other than that, my elective, so my other interest is, as you can probably tell, is trauma surgery, which I've also practiced in Johannesburg, in Soweto. My plan in the future would be to continue to improve my skills and hopefully at least yearly, more frequently if possible, to do more surgery around the world, in particularly Africa.
Okay, brilliant. And what I want to try and find out today, and I'm going to play devil's advocate a little bit in some instances, what I want to try and find out today, you know, we see a lot of stereotypes of African Caribbean men in the media. There's no way of getting around that. These are all men that I know personally, and in addition to the gentleman on the panel, there was an architect brother that couldn't make it today. There was Dr. Robbie Shilliam. There was, in our personal circle, classical composer and actor. So many, we didn't have to ring around to find professional qualified black men, believe it or not. We didn't have to, you know, go and reach for a little red book. They were right there in our circle, yet there is very little visibility of groups of men that look like this group here. Why do each of you think that is? We're going to go back into your personal lives, and if there's any X factor that you that you think you have that has made the difference, but why is there this lack of visibility then of panels that look like this one? If there is at all, as to anyone on there.
I mean, personally, I believe that studying it as an historian, it's an historical factor that goes with this. I mean, at the end of the day, we're living in a society that many a time benefits of a low impression or bad impersonation of what it means to be a black male in society. Mm-hmm. Whether we like it or not, historically, when the black man rises up in physics, only one thing can occupy the same place at the same time. So when there's a strong black male in society, then obviously many may get threatened by having that strong positive image. And I personally believe that it's our job within the community to make sure that we produce young, strong black male that are not apologetic for being strong and black and positive.
Just but male? Because, or, I know we're talking about men today. Just male or male?
Well, male and female, but I'm talking about the male today. But personally, there's an historical issue. This is not something that's brand new. Mm-hmm. Okay. And I'll never forget that, you know, as we were brought here in the 1400s or 1500s, we came as slaves. And in society, has that really changed? Maybe physically, but psychologically and spiritually, I personally believe we're still fighting for that independent black structure of what it means to be a male or a female in society.
Interesting. And how does that affect growing up? You know, you talk about working with young people, and I'm sure you all work with young people in various different capacities. What were your experiences growing up that you feel have given you the equipment to get through to the young people you're dealing with?
Well, personally speaking, you know, I was born in an average family in East London in terms of my experiences. When I went to school, in primary school, I was seen to be very advanced, very gifted. However, when I got into secondary school, the influences, seeing myself in society, didn't see in a strong role model or black role model, whatever you're okay, I bought into the stereotype. I became very immature in class. I messed around, which is like 90% of the brothers that looked like me we were doing. School didn't seem too important to me anymore. And I don't know, I'll say openly, I failed all my exams. Not because I was not intelligent, is because I fell into that stereotype of thinking that, you know, boy, being black and male, what is there to be? You know, it's just about having a good time, partying, mum's chicken on a Sunday, and then going back out again. And based on that mentality, I had no aspirations, I had no ideals. But I was blessed, and this is where the difference comes in, I was blessed to have an older brother than me, Michael, I think you know. Mm-hmm. And he mentored me. We never called it mentoring, but he showed me aspects about African history that no one ever, ever explained in their lives. And one of the basic things he taught me was something about Egypt, Kemet, that Egypt was an African civilization. Now, I said, impossible. Egypt is in the Middle East. I was so ignorant, I didn't even know where the Middle East was. And one day, I decided to look into a dictionary, an atlas, and I was blown, Akala, when I found that Egypt wasn't near Africa, it was bang inside of Africa, northeast Africa. And that alone, that experience alone, taught me that I know nothing in life. Mm. And I had to go back and reinvest in my education. I went back to college with a new ideal, a new inspiration, a new understanding of what it meant to be an African in today's society. And it helped me not socially, not just only socially and psychologically, it helped me academically. I went back into that system, educational system, and they could not give me an exam that I would not just pass, I would smash, because it gave me a new idea, a new ideal of what it means to be who I was. And that's what really changed my old perspective of who I was. And then I realized 20, 30 years later, very quickly, that many of our young boys are going through a schooling system not understanding that who they are.
It's following on from that, and then I'm going to come back to Brother Kevin Elliot, but me and you shared a very interesting moment. I don't know if you remember what I'm going to refer to. We were in a school in, I believe it was Elephant and Castle recently.
Yeah.
And I want you to reflect on a moment. There was it's a mentoring class for all young black boys. And every time one of the boys who had an African sounding name spoke, and these are all black boys in the class, all of them started bursting out with laughter. Now, if they were called, I don't know, Justin Johnson, that was fine, or Kevin, that was fine, nobody laughed. But when the Somalian brothers and the Nigerian brothers introduced themselves, they all, in concert, immediately. What do you think that tells us about what you're just reflecting on?
It basically tells me nothing has changed in 20, 30 years. I'm going to be honest with everyone in the audience. I was a part of that mentality in my school days. We laughed, we used to cuss or diss each other based on who's the blackest. Mm. And if anyone came to our school with an African-sounding name, I'll be in the first of it, trying to diss them and cuss them about, look at your African head, your African name. We were made, without even knowing it, subconsciously, we were made to hate each other or hate ourselves quite deep. And that self-hatred manifests itself in the way we treated each other. And it's sad to say, Brother Carla, that when you came into that school with myself, it's only a few weeks ago, in truth, it was about a month or two months ago, in 20 to 30 years later, we are still having that same mentality and that same discourse within our own community on, putting each other down based on African names, African cultures, what have you. Nothing's really changed.
So what about for you, Dr. Elliot? You're being the only one that was born in Africa. Was your experience different, even though you grew up here? Being born in Nigeria, did that make you view Africanness differently, or do you feel that you internalized some of what we're talking about here?
It's interesting. I don't think I did. I wasn't aware of it for much of my educational path because I was born there. I had a really strong sense of being African. I lived in Benin City, Nigeria, until the age of 4. And I came here with the name Elliot, so it wasn't very African. I never experienced, I think I was quite flexible, quite mobile in terms of racially. I didn't have an awareness of the challenges that maybe would face me in the future. The other thing that I had quite strongly from my father was the African mentality. So first generation African coming to this country, certainly his message was education. Now, it was a strong message that I've continued to follow, and it was a good message because I always followed the educational path, but it wasn't always the complete message because I'd ask him questions. Dad, what subject should I pick? The answer was education. I feel anxious about the exam. Pass it. It's a very limited input, but I knew that I was supposed to follow education, and I didn't really face the same kinds of anxieties about my own heritage. I was quite clear, and what I would do is gravitate towards the other African or Nigerian boys, introduce myself, but also I think maybe it was a privilege to be able to be quite fluid. So I didn't feel that until probably later when I became a man and understood probably some of the challenges that I could have dealt with better.
Interesting. Just picking back up on that for a moment, because of course for mine and yourself both being mixed, why do you think it is, in your personal experience, I know I have my own reasons, but why do you feel that you gravitated towards your Nigerian heritage, as you're saying you did? If any reason at all.
I don't know if there is a reason. I first and foremostly do see myself as black, and why that is, I don't think I've quite worked out. You know, I've been in discussions, and it's that's just where I end up in my mentality. But it was certainly where I felt comfortable, maybe being born there, but also it was somewhere where I could relate. I gained my strength and probably my confidence in education and any challenge, probably from my dad and my mum, who just said, you can do anything. So certainly getting that message was probably where I sought it in my fellow African people. Yeah.
Cool. And what about you, Brother Kevin? Talk to us a little bit about your upbringing, where you grew up, challenges you face, your neighbourhood, etc., and why you think, if there is a particular reason or X factor that took you from A to B.
I honestly don't think there was a particular reason or X factor. I grew up in London Borough of Brent, in Wembley, near to Stonebridge Park tube station, so near the Stonebridge Estate. Mother an African from Jamaica, although she would never, ever call herself an African from Jamaica. Father, an African from Barbados. Ditto with respect to the African identity. But you know, I grew up loving cricket. I loved cricket. Yeah. I had love for cricket, and I had love for the West Indies cricket team. And I honestly think that the West Indies cricket team made of me a proto-Pan-Africanist. That the West Indies cricket team of the 1970s and 80s would beat everybody all the time in every manner, in almost every game. They would win, and win again, and win in a way, especially when Viv Richards became the captain, would win in a way which was an assertion of African pride. He would wear the red, gold, and green on his wrists. He would walk with this strut, with his head held up to the crease. He would take on all comers without a helmet. And he would hit them for six. And I know, as a kid growing up, that had a huge impression on me. And I also know, my parents weren't particularly Pan-Africanist or anything, but they were definitely parents who made me recognize that I had to be in competition with the white kids. I went to Catholic schools from the age of 5 to 18. And invariably, the black kids were in the minority in those schools. Sometimes, certainly in my secondary school, there was only ever two or three of us in any year. In primary school, it was a bit more. So whiteness was something against which I had to compete, and I had to win. I had to beat them. And I'm using that very male imagery there. But there was something to that. Yeah. I had to run faster. I had to jump higher. I had to be better in the classroom. I had to be better. And that's never quite left me. That's never quite left. And it's got me into difficulties as a professional.
Go on.
As an adult, trying to deal with... I mean, I define Africans in this society as we are a cohabiting nationality. We're not a minority, we're not ethnic minorities, we are a cohabiting nationality. But we cohabit with others who are greater in numbers than ourselves. And so you have to deal as a professional, as an adult, not just as a professional, in all work environments, and not just work environments, with all of those meta vibes and other interpersonal relationship and power defined discourses, which determine how far you get as a professional, how far you get in the world of work. And there's been times when I've questioned how much of the boy that I was still stays with me as a man. How much of that do I need? How much of that should I discard? What makes a man and not a boy? Recognising, as we do as Africans, from the diaspora in particular, the pejorative connotations of being referred to as a black man, as a boy. But knowing also that childishness and childhood and youthfulness is something that you want to retain also, because it's pregnant with possibility, and you're constantly making yourself and remaking yourself and remaking yourself. So this is something which I'm quite comfortable with not having crystallised the answer, Brother Akala. Mm-hmm. I'm cool with that. I don't mind having not having crystallised the answer. And I also recognise that when asked that question as to what was special, or what can I put my finger on which made me who I am, there's loads of things one could talk about. One could talk about also as I made a decision, 16, 17, 18, I made a decision that going out for me was not sitting in the corner of a pub, and when the pub closes at 11 o'clock going home. I wanted to listen to reggae music. I wanted to go to the clubs that my brother, who was 5 years older than me, was going to. I wanted to be a soul boy. I wanted to check for women. And I wanted to be a young black man. I could remember wanting to be black.
Yeah.
And not wanting to be the black guy, which I would have been if I'd stayed in that group of friends I had when I was 14, 15, 16, which revolved around school. And so one had to look for poles of reference in relation to that. Mm. And that yearning, that looking, also helped me, Brother Andrew's touched upon this self-education that we have in order to make of ourselves who we are in connection with our history. You've had to do so, we've all had to do so, we will know it, those of us in the audience as well, sisters and brothers. Mm. We have to reach out and find our history. We have to reach out and claim it, find it, understand it, make it relevant to us and meaningful to us, not crystallise it or ossify it, and not worship it in some sort of deified way, which I believe in some circles does take place. And also recognise that we are of a diaspora.
Yeah.
And I'll get back to cricket again, because I would watch the West Indies cricket team. I would understand as I got older that was really, apart from CARICOM, the only formation in which those little neo-colonialist microstates worked together as a unit. I would recognise something of possibility there, African strength, African possibility. And it made me proud of myself as a teenager. It made me strong in the playground. And that allied with my academic ability, because I was good academically, and I was reasonably good sports-wise, but I think I was only considered reasonably good because, you know, I had projections on me. I was the black guy, so, you know, he must be good.
What was that like, though? I mean, you grew up in one of the most, for want of a better word, segregated parts of London, one of the blackest and roughest parts of London, the Stonebridge Estate. You went to a predominantly white Catholic school. You ended up studying at Cambridge, your brother at Oxford. Why, though? You know, I'm not saying there is a particular one spot you can pin on. You've talked about cricket being one of these things that gave you pride, but how, coming from that environment, did your family produce one brother who goes to Cambridge and another brother who goes to Oxford? But yet, you still seem very connected to where you came from.
I had an older sister who went to a school called Convent of Jesus and Mary in Harlesden. She came out of school with virtually no qualifications. I had an older brother who went to a school called Cardinal Hinsley. he came out of school with one GCSE. My mother took a decision that she was going to ship me out of Brent for school-wise, and I went to a school in a place called Ickenham, near Weiss. I'd never heard of Ickenham. I'd never heard of this place. I cried when I had to go there at 11. so I went to this Catholic school. My mum insisted I go to a Catholic mixed school. So I go to this school in Ickenham. And so you get on with it as a kid because you've got no choice and your autonomy is limited and your agency is nil. I was always good academically. And to be honest, the fact that there was even more white people and even less black people made me even more competitive. I was extremely competitive. as a young person. I had a,
are you speaking specifically racially in this context?
Specifically racially. I wanted to be better in class because I wanted to show that I was better than the white kids. I wanted to be better. And I sensed that, and I would be upset with myself and angry with myself if I came second or third. And those areas where I wasn't good, like I was, to this day I can barely swim, and I would bunk swimming lessons because I didn't want to show that I wasn't really that good at it. Mm. I wasn't really great in physics and chemistry and whatever. I got a D in physics at O level. And once I realised that I didn't have a huge aptitude, I'm not saying this is right, but once I realised I didn't have a huge aptitude for the sciences, I kind of just allowed it and then focused on those areas, languages, history, the social sciences, English, where I knew I could fly. And I knew I could show them. And then I could feign sort of an indifference about other things because I didn't want to, you know, I didn't want to show that I was really trying to do my best, but I weren't all that.
Interesting. Back to you, Dr. Elliot. You almost had an alternative, completely alternative career path. Talk to us a little bit about that.
Yes, it's actually interesting you're talking about the sporting reference because my background and how I met Kingsley was I signed my first professional football contract at Wimbledon when they were in the Premiership, and that was one of a few professional associations. I played for England as a junior and had the privilege of playing in France and Hungary, amongst other places. So it was often a reference for me as well. My hero, I remember being in Liverpool early on, was with John Barnes, who I was absolutely sure was the best football player, probably in the world, but certainly in England. So it gave me a reference, not necessarily educational, but certainly he was the best and he was black. So it's something that I kept referring back to, and then I go to school, along with my academia, my dad's words ringing in my ear, it would be, to be the fastest, and I was the fastest. So it gave me a little bit more confidence every time I went through that process, and it lasted a long time. It lasted, I guess, until recently. Now I'm a man, I'm open, and I'm in the world just as a doctor. But up to about probably 4 years ago, I was still involved with professional football or semi-professional football, and had people, you know, referring to me as a footballer. I think Kingsley will probably shoot me if I don't mention. So what I gained was the European Sports Forum Award for academic achievement amongst elite sports people. And so up to very recently, it's been something that's always reassured me of my talent, the sporting talent. The educational stuff has probably been a little bit of a side element. Just, you know, keep going because Dad says so and because my mum was a teacher. So. I think I gained a lot of my self-confidence actually from my greater talents as opposed to having a specific role model within an educational or a professional field, which I can't say I did have.
But why do you think that you, because having played football with you and played football generally for quite some time, the environment is not conducive to academic success. Not just for young black boys, but for boys who play football. It's not like America where if your grades are not up to par, you lose the job, you're out. The American scholarship system is one of the very few policies I would look at that America has, and I would have to overwhelmingly say is massively positive, where if you're a young, talented sportsman, you literally will not be allowed to play if you don't get your degree. In England, that is not the case at all. In fact, me and you were the really only two footballers I knew of, maybe one or two others that were interested in academia. I'd stopped going to college at this point, but I read, and that made us outcasts and exceptions in some way, but how do you think, I remember people joking about you being a doctor and stuff like that at Wimbledon and making fun of you. Obviously, why do you think you had the strength to continue rather than say, well, I'm going to be a footballer anyway, so whatever?
It's interesting. I don't really have the answer to that question. I always remember the sense of embarrassment, and I kind of kept a lot of when I used to play football, I used to keep it inside. I wouldn't be the doctor or the person that was interested in academia. It would be deep down inside. I'd go home and read a few more books. It wasn't something that was openly allowed within the sporting context. I didn't feel like it was. I felt embarrassed. But what gave me the strength, I guess, was my enjoyment. It was maybe a stroke of luck that I enjoyed playing football, and I really enjoyed or had gained an enthusiasm for education by luck. You know, some of the decisions that I have made as, you know, as a 16-year-old choosing GCSEs or 18-year-old choosing A-levels weren't because I had the greatest advice or because of something magical. I think there was a little bit of luck, and I think that's something that I would pass on to people making those same decisions, that it shouldn't be about luck. I had the enthusiasm. I had the talent, but I did rely on choices, because had I made other choices at certain moments, I wouldn't have been in the same position.
It's very interesting the way a person's self-perception can be so different from their perception of others, because I remember when we were... So I was at West Ham for 3 years and then played for Wimbledon with Elliot back when they were in the Premier League. We had that because they're in, like, Division X or whatever it is now. That wouldn't really be professional or to the same standard. But I remember thinking actually completely opposite. I remember thinking, wow, like, this guy has deliberately chosen to take on a seven-year degree or how many years, almost a decade of study, even whilst he's got the stress of playing professional football 6 days a week. And I remember feeling luck had nothing to do with it, and you'd made a very deliberate, very conscious, very determined choice. You may see that as luck, but I didn't know another single footballer, black, white, or any other nationality, that had chosen at 18 years old to do that. So it seems to me, from the outside looking in, that luck had absolutely... And I was sure in myself that if you didn't become a footballer, you'd definitely be a doctor. Right? And so that is the way I saw it. It was very, very different to maybe your seeing of it.
Yeah, no, it's interesting to reflect that. Genuinely, I don't know. It was a real sense of anxiety. I had to learn to swear when we were in the football. I didn't do it at home. My dad had, if I did that, my dad would have done something to me. My mum didn't swear. And I had to learn. I went into this football scene where we were taught to be rough and boisterous and swear and you saw it on TV, and that was the way to. That was what was populated in the media. So it was an interesting thing and a real sense. Yeah, I'd say a sense of anxiety trying to fit into two things.
Okay, very interesting, Brother Andrew. To return to you, I remember when I was. I'm not gonna. I was younger. I'm not going to say how old I was. I don't want to put you on the spot. But when I was in school, Brother Andrew came to my school. My school had a project called the Outreach Project, which was unashamedly about reaching young African Caribbean boys, particularly, and teaching them knowledge of self, history, culture, but mentoring them. Which, interestingly, my school that I used to go to has abolished this program now, for various reasons, which I find interesting because. We can all acknowledge black men are overrepresented in the criminal justice system, in the mental health institutions, in all of these things, in deaths in custody. We can have a police force, Operation Trident, specifically to police black-on-black violence. But when a school program is developed to tackle these issues, it was set up by a black teacher, male teacher, who was 6'8" and 20 stone, literally. So that helped him with his air of authority, right? But it was set up by him, and it was successful. All of us that went to this program, most of us didn't get expelled, we passed our GCSEs. All of my friends that didn't go, because I was friends with all the bad boys as well, they didn't come to outreach, they did get expelled, right? So it was a successful program, yet the school abolished it, which has its own food for thought. But Brother Andrew came into my school and gave us a history lesson, right? And I remember I was 11 at the time, I will say, right? And I just remember being so enthralled with this guy who was just like a walking brain. Like, there was no person there. There was just walking grey matter, right? And it just... It was so appealing to me. Like, this was right in the time of Wu-Tang, for anyone who's a hip-hop head here, right? So this was a time at which the Wu-Tang Clan was spreading ideas of knowledge as being young and black and masculine, which was something revolutionary. A lot of people don't realize that. They didn't speak differently. They didn't pretend they didn't come from the ghetto. Many of them had been shot and gone to prison, yet they would use words like benevolent in a rap song. And I'd be like, what does benevolent mean, right? And I'd go to the dictionary. So in this period of time and in that environment, this outreach project, Brother Andrew comes to my school. And I would actually describe his presence in my school personally as being one of the defining moments of my time in school. I literally remember the day like it was yesterday, and he told me that I was like Imhotep. I didn't know who Imhotep was at the time. Right? I read a poem about history, and I remember taking that as the hugest compliment ever, even though I didn't know who Imhotep was yet, found out who he was. I reflect on that just to talk about how your presence impacted me, but also for you to please reflect on what some of the great moments have been for you in your journey and working with young men. What have been the fruits?
I mean, that is a great question, Brother Akala. And as I said, my brother was, I could say, one of the key elements which allowed me to appreciate that this world is more than what I thought it was. And he made me appreciate that more that a man knows is the more that he understands that he doesn't know. A wise man knows himself to be ignorant, whilst a fool sees himself as being wise. And when I understood that little principle, that, hold on a minute, Andrew, how come there's so much of this universe you know nothing about? He took me on a path of learning. And he introduced me to great people of history, great people of present times. And each one of those people had a massive impact on myself. I remember, as my brother here stated earlier, about the environment that he was in. Okay, he had to be the best. One of the things my brother said to me when I failed all my exams, he said, go back to college and get an education. And that to me was very powerful, because I thought, you know, it's just about passing exams. He said, no, the word education comes from the two Latin words, educare, means to bring out the genius that's within you. You are born with that genius. You've got to, your duty whilst you're on this earth is to understand your genius and bring it out. And I went back to that college, and he said this to me, and I use this with all the young people. He said, friends are like elevators. Some friends will take you up in life, but other friends will bring you down in life. And I had to change my environment of the kind of friends I was hanging around with. And it's interesting to note, and I'll have to say the truth, when I decided consciously to change my group of friends, and I wanted to move with friends that are going to be aiming high, with high aspirations, with self-belief, I realized that I was hanging around with a whole new set of friends, and they were mainly Asian, to be honest with you. And they were very competitive in class. And just by hanging around with them, I found myself being very competitive for the first time in class. You know, because if you go back into our school days, the sporting people got the big medals and the trophies, and we, as men, masculine men, we are very competitive, I believe, in nature. And so if you're in school, you're in an environment whereby the biggest medal is always related to football or athletics. You're aiming for that medal. But then those who may have done the spelling test, or what they call the spelling bee, or done well in their class exams, they didn't get any medal. Or if they did get medal, it'd be like a little prefect. That, to me, was not what I was aiming for. I wanted the big medal. But then by changing a lot of my friends, and they were more competitive in the class, just by hanging around with them, I found that our discourse changed. My values in life changed, and values dictate your decisions in life. So when my value system changed, I realized it ain't about the big medals that I can put on my wall, it's about what I can put on my chest and in my mind. I found myself being very competitive with the academia part of my friends, and that changed me. And then lastly, and I'll go into just a touch on the young boys that I'm working with now, very, very briefly. I was blessed to meet one of my greatest goal models in life. That's Muhammad Ali. And he said, if you want to change the world, you must first change your attitude to yourself. It's very simple words, but it blew my mind. And I found that that was my foundation. It wasn't about pointing the finger blaming society, whether it be white, Asian, black, or whatever, whether it be blaming the police or the court system. Because I realized with my attitude, I dictated my decision and my destiny in life. And I realized that every time I pointed the finger blaming someone else, there was always three fingers pointing back at me. That made me three times more responsible for where I'm heading. And so the first course I decided to do when I set up my company was attitude determines altitude. It's not based on a color. It's not even based on an ideology. It's not even based on a faith. It's first your attitude to who you are. And so that to me is the foundation. And when I see my young people that are teaching schools now, I understand that the attitude is fundamental, then everything else changes. And my last point, because I know my brother's twitching there, my last point is this, and this is my last point, is that, and I took a very, I'll use the word courageous decision, Akala, because when I realized I left school and I was totally ignorant on anything in life, I decided I didn't want my children to repeat daddy's path. I took my children out of the schooling system. They never went one day in the educational system in this country. Yeah, they were home taught. They were taught by other Africans that had high aspirations. We made them move with different friends that was with each other. And when Ofsted came to inspect our children that we taught, they found they were 2 years in advance of the education system in this country. My son's left now, he's got his BA honours and whatever, my daughter, they've all academically reached.
No, don't just skip over your daughter, brother. No. I know what your daughter's
but the point I'm trying to say.
But just for the record, just talk a little bit about what it is your daughter studies and what
She's done being homeschooled.
My first daughter, my son has got his BA honours, he's doing his marketing company. In fact, you're doing an event for him next month at Jazz Cafe on the 23rd of, no promotion. So he's doing his marketing business. My daughter's in London School of Fashion. She's doing her degree, finishing her degree in textile and design. My other daughter, she's doing a PhD in architecture in Nottingham and so on. And so these are people who literally had to understand it's their attitude to who they are first. Okay. Don't be ashamed of who you are.
Brother Kevin, I'm sure you've got a lot to say about attitude and then about the interplay between personal conceptions and society and the very real pressures and stuff like that that exists, but I won't put words in your mouth. So.
No, I was just having a little joke to myself about about one or two things that Brother Andrew said. When Brother Andrew, not laughing at what Brother Andrew said, but making of something a joke, so I'll share the joke. And it was in relation to when Brother Andrew said that he met one of his gold models, Muhammad Ali, and there was a slight pregnant pause, and then Muhammad Ali said, and it just to me it would be interesting if Muhammad Ali had said, take a seat, or if Muhammad Ali said, do you want ketchup or do you want salad cream? Or if Muhammad Ali said, like the shoes. Because of all of the things that Muhammad Ali could have said, perhaps those would have been more normal things for Muhammad Ali to say. I remember meeting one of my heroes up to the point when I met him, a man called Sir Garfield Sobers, Gary Sobers. Gary Sobers, and for those of you who aren't cricket aficionados, will probably go down in history as the world's greatest ever all-round cricketer. Anyway, as luck would have it, Gary Sobers, about a decade or so ago, found himself playing dominoes in a pub not far from where I was living at the time, just around the corner from Ladbroke Grove train station at Westbourne Park. A community organiser who I knew at the time called me up and said, Brother Kevin, you've got to come down, man. You know, Gary Sobers is going to be, you know, he's going to be at this pub and it'd be good for you to meet him. I know how you love your cricket. And so I finish work. I go down to this pub. There's all of these elders playing dominoes and I know a few of them and we're talking. I gingerly make my way to Gary Sobers. And I can't remember what he said, to be honest. So it's not so much what he said, but what I do know is that he was more or less saying to me, come out my way, man, I'm playing dominoes.
That's amazing.
And the reason why I think that is useful is because I think there is a limited use to the notion of mentoring and the notion of role models.
Yes, sir.
And I'll say quite clearly, because you said let's not be modest, I consider my politics to be pan-Africanist and to be revolutionary socialist and to seek to engage that in actual practice. It's not to be ideologically pure in a corner. And to deal with my work and the political aspects of it in terms of collective action, collective engagement, and collective solutions to problems which hit us, mash us up, beat us up, collectively. And so in trying to understand what it is to be a man, we have to look into collective understandings of African manhood and ways in which white supremacy hasn't been mentioned yet, but I'll mention it, ways in which white supremacy and its sister, white skin privilege, which are both progeny of capitalism, ways in which they have endured in our hearts and minds and souls, which both create identities, delineate certain spaces where, as an African man, you're not supposed to trespass. So I find it interesting to try to understand why it is very often that when we are trying to, because we're talking about men today, when we are trying to encourage and empower our young African males, why it is, in my view, unfortunately, many of the structured mentoring programs which exist are akin in many respects to NGOs which go into Africa. And these NGOs might do good work. Some of them do good work. They'll build a well here and they'll do this there. But do they really lead to self-determination? Do they really lead to an empowerment, a collective empowerment, where doing for self is the ultimate goal? And do they really do anything other than mirror that system of oppression which makes the necessity for the NGO in the first place? And when we then look at structured mentoring organisations which exist, and very often if I meet a professional, because this is the professionals panel, we have called ourselves a certain priesthood called professionals, and we've separated ourselves from those who are somehow other than professional. And that's again debatable or worthy of dialogue. But do we not see that when we go into our communities talk about empowering and engaging and mentoring an individual, aside from all of the SHIT about ourselves individually, which we hide from the mentee, aside from all of that, can we not see that we are doing nothing other than mirroring the limits which society has imposed upon them in the first place, and just shuffling a chosen few, into areas of possibility? Now, I use the analogy of a dam. And this dam is overflowing, it's got leaks in it. And mentoring, you'll take your gloves off, you'll get your fingers, and you'll put your fingers in the holes in the dam. And when you put your fingers in the holes in the dam, you can point to drops of water on the other side, which you have definitely saved. And you can hold these drops of water up and say, look, mentoring does work. Look at those drops of water. You can get the drops of water to testify. Yep, I'm a drop of water, and if it hadn't been for him, for this mentor, I don't know where I would be. I'd have evaporated. But yet, the flood tide still continues. The flood tide still drowns. And we don't have collective solutions and collective understandings of how to build a new dam, or indeed whether a dam is necessary, or change the flow. And I talk about all of that because I think that also determines discussions about what it is to be an African man, and how we have to reclaim, because you know what it's like, Akala. We create, and I think humans do, humans full stop, but we're talking about Africans, and we're talking about African men. We create and recreate ourselves again and again and again, and even more so when you're doing so. When you have a subaltern voice against the oppression of white supremacy, even more so, you have to clear your throat and say to the world, "I will not let you determine who I am. I will not let you say, look, I know just what's right for you. I can see you're going to be just this sort of professional." And everyone will pat you in the back, and maybe internally you're miserable. I'll tell you something, I went to Cambridge, and my younger brother, 8 years, 9 years younger, went to Oxford. And he only went to Oxford because, went to the same state school, but he only went to Oxford because he didn't want to completely follow my path. He wanted to be a bit different because everyone was saying, oh, you're just like your brother. And he got fed up with it, to be honest, yeah? Mm-hmm. As you can imagine. There's a process which we also have to engage with and understand, by which in getting education, we educate ourselves away from ourselves as Africans. We educate ourselves away from ourselves. Brother Andrew talks about hanging out with some Asian young people and getting that competitive element. I talked about being sent to a school in a place called Ickenham, away from black people. We educate ourselves away from ourselves. We get into Oxford and Cambridge, and everyone pats us on the back and says, well done, well done. And you then have to deal with this environment which is not necessarily you. You're still in the process of changing from boy to adolescent to man, but yet you have to kind of manifest well done. Now, and that doesn't stop at the educational level. That's the same in the professions, that's the same throughout, where there is this push and pull. I'll give you one example of my work. Although it was not work-related. I was coming home from a date about 2 or 3 years ago, and got to a bus stop in Swiss Cottage, after she had gone home, and I arrive at this bus stop, and there's about, this is a difficult anecdote, there's about seven or eight young black youth, African, African Caribbean youth, and they're at the bus stop too. It's about 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. And this looked like they're having a good time. Everything looks cool. I see them in me. I think they see me in them. So I say to them, you know, it's what you lot been up to then. Like that. Why did I say that? Why did I say that? The moment I said that, I thought the situation was cool, and maybe this says something about myself. The moment I said that, the situation switched. What, you batty man, what, why are you questioning me? Is he a batty man, And they were stepping towards me with a degree of aggression. I think I'm talking to my people. I think I'm talking to some young guys. So what, are you feds? He looks like a police officer, shall we rush him? The whole atmosphere changed. Now, if I had been, which I'm not, but if I had been at all aggressive or at all wanting to preserve some false ego in that situation, I'd have got my ass kicked. At least. That would have been a lucky escape from the scenario. I had to hold it down, whoa, engage and focus on one of them who was a bit kind of embarrassed. You can see one of them was a bit... And I had to say, hey, whoa, chill out, guys. I'm a criminal lawyer. I had to say that. Oh, whoa, give us your card. I had to say that, but the reason why I mentioned that is because I don't know what I was doing. I don't know what I was thinking, saying to them, what have you lot been doing tonight? In what they would have seen as a interrogating way, but I just thought I was talking to my people. But they heard my voice, they saw my dress, they saw my demeanor, I wasn't of them. As far as they were concerned, in that context, who are you to chat to us about what we've been doing and where we've been going?
Very interesting. And on that note, thank you very much, everybody.